أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. آمين.
میرا نام سید محمود ہے اور میں ایم پیک کو سپورٹ کر رہا ہوں، اس لیے کہ یہ ہمارے لوگوں میں اویئرنیس لے کے آ رہے ہیں، اور یہ جیسے ایم پیک اس کا نام ہے، مسلم پولیٹیکل ایکشن کمیٹی، اور ان لوگوں کا ایجنڈا جو ہے وہ بہت بڑا ہے، اور اللہ اس کو ان کو کامیاب کرے اس میں. میں ان کو اس طرح سپورٹ کر رہا ہوں کہ یہ میرے گھر میں ہو رہا ہے اس وقت ایونٹ، اور اس میں جو لوگ شامل ہیں وہ بہت قابل لوگ ہیں، اور یہ جو کام کرنا چاہتے ہیں ہماری کمیونٹی کے لیے اس میں ہم ان کو سپورٹ کر رہے ہیں.
لیڈیز اینڈ جینٹلمین، وی ہیو سم ڈگنیٹریز فرام ڈیموکریٹک پارٹی، دی الیکٹڈ آفیشلز آف نیو یارک اسٹیٹ. وی ہیو مسٹر کیری ایسولاجس، ہی از اے کاؤنٹی لیجسلیٹر، نیسا کاؤنٹی لیجسلیٹر، اینڈ وی ہیو مس آر چیف گیسٹ آف دی ایوننگ مسٹر فل راموس. ہی از دی ہائی رینکنگ ڈیموکریٹک پارٹی لیڈر، اینڈ ہی از دا ڈیپٹی میجورٹی لیڈر آف نیو یارک اسٹیٹ اسمبلی. ویلکم پیپل. دس از اے میٹنگ وی آر ڈوئنگ فار ایم پیک. ایم پیک مسلم پیک، مسلم پولیٹیکل ایکشن کمیٹی is run by two very distinguished gentlemen, young fellows, and they have some big agenda to follow. I will invite my nephew and the president of AMPAC, Amir Sultan, to introduce and tell us about AMPAC.
Thank you again for all of you for coming in this bad weather and honoring us, and special thanks to special guests, my mentor and teacher, Deputy Majority Leader, Assemblyman Phil Ramos. Thanks so much for coming. And my good friend, Kerry Esolajes, we will be working with you a lot in the near future. They've been introduced, so I don't need to go more into detail of, who they are. And we have a special guest, Teresa Sanders from Urban League. Welcome, Teresa. Thanks for coming. I've been working for Phil for about 6 months now, and on and off, he's proven himself to be a great leader and a consistent supporter of minorities and Muslim community, regardless of the populism that's out there, the negative rhetoric that's being spun for Muslims and the community and minorities. The idea of MPAC was conceived while working with Phil on local Muslim social issues, and we felt the urgency or the need to have a unified political body to address the concerns and needs of the local Muslim community. Well, like many other minority and immigrant groups who have gone through difficult times and transitions, and they have come out successful out of them, and they have become an integral part of the society. We, on the other hand, as Muslim Americans, are also going through the same cycle. We are an affluent group. We have done well economically by working hard and educating our children, but there remains a huge gap, right? When it comes to our involvement in the socio-political landscape of our country, we are lacking. We are lacking way far behind. We are lacking in the voting process, as well as our direct involvement in local governance, such as school boards, local town halls, right? So we need to be extremely proactive in filling these gaps. Well, the urgency to bridge this gap is immediate, as of yesterday. We should have done this long time ago. But it's never too late. We're starting now, and we hope to continue doing this. And with your support, obviously with your support. Well, our disconnect from the political landscape has, you know, emboldened individuals like Donald Trump and other fearmongers, you know, and bigots to target our community for their ill-gained personal and political benefits by spreading Islamophobia and xenophobia. So we have to raise our voices against these demagogues. Well, not in our defense. You know, we don't have to say we are not ISIS and or we don't do this, we don't do that. We have to demand our God-given rights and constitutional rights within the bounds of law. And on the same hand, we need to realize our roles and responsibilities as law-abiding citizens. The need to fill these voids brought to us the idea of MPAC USA. And with guidance from Phil, we came together to mobilize the local Muslim community of Long Island and New York City. Thanks for that, Phil. Since its recent inception, MPAC USA has mobilized volunteers for Ali Najmi, a friend of mine who ran for city council in Queens, who campaigned door-to-door to promote his candidacy. We have been actively involved in voter registration campaigns in New York City and Long Island, in which we intend to pursue more rigorously with your assistance. We do have registration forms here, and we will pass them on, you know, to you guys. Our efforts thus far have been recognized at the African American and Hispanic Caucus on Long Island and Puerto Rico, where we had the honor of being introduced to Governor Cuomo and Mayor de Blasio. On January 12, 2016, MPAC USA had the privilege of being introduced and announced on the floor of the National Assembly in the opening session by Mr. Phil Ramos. Please give him a hand of applause. Well, having said all that, now I'm going to get to the business. Our agenda comprises of working in collaboration with other organizations, individuals, and politicians to address these issues that directly and indirectly affect our immediate community and children's future. Issues such as Islamophobia, political rights and responsibilities, social rights and responsibilities, as well as economic support and well-being of Muslims are our top priority. MPAC USA has short and long-term goals and a very precise and clear agenda to serve the Muslim community and its interests, details of which will be provided shortly by my friend Mr. Athar here. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to thank you and welcome you all to the first annual gala of MPAC USA and for the overwhelming support that you have shown us and our distinguished guests. On that note, I'll hand over the mic to Mr. Mahmood, our gracious host for this evening.
Now I'm going to request Mr. Salajas to say a few words.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Carrier Salaj, and I am a county legislator representing the great areas of Elmont, Valley Stream, Floral Park, Inwood, North Woodmere. It is an honor to be here tonight. I also am here tonight representing my sister, who is also an elected official. She's an assemblywoman. In fact, she's the first assemblywoman of Haitian descent in New York State. And she could not be here tonight because she is, along with many of my friends and my brother, they're in New Hampshire supporting a certain candidate who I believe is the strongest candidate to make sure that Donald Trump does not become president. But I would like first to thank our host and our hostess for allowing us to be here in your beautiful home. I would like to thank my friends, Athia and Amir, for having me here tonight. And also my good friend and someone who I look up to in politics, and that is our great assemblyman, Mr. Ramos. Thank you so much for being here and inviting me. I'm here tonight to first talk to you about something very important that's happening in American politics now, and that is the demonizing of an entire people, the Muslim community, as we have seen with rhetoric by different political leaders. And that's very damaging, because as a Haitian American, I distinctly remember in the 80s when they accused Haitians of coming to this country with HIV, bringing crime, disease, and when people say that, about you and your culture, it makes you feel inhuman. And once you feel inhuman, you feel that you do not deserve to see yourself in public office. You do not deserve to have good things happen to you and to your community. I strongly stand here tonight denouncing any such statements. We cannot afford that in this great country, this country built by immigrants like my parents and like many people here in this room and people who have come before us who built this great country. And so once you see yourself as a person or as a worldly people, not just as a minority, you instinctively know that you deserve the best, not the piece of the pie, but the whole pie. And that's what we are trying to accomplish here as a community here in the United States. We want to see our sons and daughters in positions of influence to help others, to bring others up. You know, when I was at Georgetown, I remember reading the Quran, the Holy Quran, and I love that religion, a very peaceful religion. It recognizes my Savior, Jesus Christ, as a prophet. And that religion in the Quran, it says that God helps those who help themselves. Well, God bless you because you're helping yourself here tonight by forming and growing this political organization. That is very important to do so. And I am here not just tonight, but I'll be here with you over the next several months and years. I'm not going anywhere, God willing, inshallah. Because it won't be easy. We'll engage in a pathway in which we must select young people in our community to groom, to get into government jobs, and to grow, and to organize, and to register voters, and to inform people that they have a right in their local government. I share with you that same interest. I would like to see the Haitian community, the Latino community, all hold hands together and create a new coalition of minorities that will determine the future that we have in this great country. We cannot do it alone. We must do it with all of our communities combined, holding hands together and moving forward together. And I'm so glad that we have a leader like Phil Ramos to share that vision with all of us. But it will take hard work and it will be painful. But I have an expression. Pain is temporary, but victory is forever. We could accomplish that. It is possible. But you must believe in yourself and organize yourself and your community. And so these young people here tonight, and they're young guys, they are. They have a large task before them, but they need your help. They need young people, you know, unpaid staff who are willing to do the grunt work of handing out voter registration forms. They need young people to get involved. I'm so happy that I have people in my community, people like Malik, who helped me in my political career. And I sincerely believe that in Southeast Queens or Southwest Nassau County, where I represent, we will see one of the first South Asians elected into office. I truly believe in the next several years. And I want to make sure I can see that happening. Like my ancestors in Haiti, they were not satisfied with securing their own freedom in 1804, becoming the first black independent republic. They helped Simón Bolívar, for example, organized and gave him troops and soldiers so that he could help liberate South America, which is why many South American countries and their flags have the red, white, and blue from Haiti. And in the same way, I would like to help liberate and organize other communities. Because it's not just about my community. I want to see other communities gain the respect and privilege that they deserve in this great country. And so I am very happy to be here tonight. I'm an attorney, so I can speak forever. But I don't, because I would like to hear questions from a lot of great people here in this room. You know, this is a great community. Just like my community, many medical professionals, many people who believe in hard work. That's great. That's amazing. Please give yourself credit. You had one of the first parades to showcase and display the beautifulness of your culture last year. Give yourself some credit for that. That is not common. We must take every chance to define our own future and to define our own culture so that other people don't define it for us. I really mean that. That's very, very important to define your own future.
Now I'm going to invite someone, a distinguished guest. He's the first Hispanic on Long Island as an elected member of New York State Assembly, champion of the civil rights, first politician who has reached a Muslim community. Our guest of honor for the evening, Mr. Phil Ramos, Assemblyman.
Thank you. Thank you. Please put your hands together for our gracious host, Mr. Mahmoud. His lovely wife, Ms. Shabbat, Dr. Shabbat. Thank you so much. I look out here and you know, to me, this is a really, really proud day. This is a historic day for the Muslim community. I see the leaders out there. I see Mr. Malik. I see the Turkish community here. I see people from Pakistan. I see people from Asian countries. I see African Americans here. I see Puerto Ricans here. I see Dominicans here. This is what we're talking about. You know, we're talking about that diversity is the tide that rises all ships. Before I start, I want to tell you the basic premise of what I try and do. There is an African proverb that says, if you want to go somewhere fast, if you want to go fast, go alone. If you want to go far, go together. If your community and our community wants to go far, we must do it together. Now, before we get to talking about the organizational efforts, I got to tell you that we started this effort, and I met with these wonderful young people from your community to talk about organizing the Muslim community. And what I saw in the years that I've been in office and I observed the Muslim community, I see so many parallels in the evolution of the Hispanic community and in the evolution of the African-American community in their civic engagement. So I'm going to share with you some sometimes brutally honest observations that we have about our respective communities. And before we can get to organizing and changing some of the things that we want to change in this community and being part of many things, we must first reflect on ourselves and say, what do we have to do first? What do we have to do as a community? What does the Muslim community have to do? I will tell you that when I took office 15 years ago, Hispanics have been on Long Island since the 40s. And 15 years ago, I was the first Hispanic elected. That shows you how long it took for the Hispanic community to start to get their foot in the door to be empowered. When I got elected, I noticed one thing about my community. Disorganized. It was a community that had immigrated. You're going to see a lot of parallels in what I'm saying. When I first got elected, you want to know who the biggest grief I got from? Hispanic leaders. Hispanic leaders. You're going to see it in your own community. You're going to see that young leaders come up, and maybe some old-time leaders feel a little bit threatened by that. That's natural. That's natural. And the maturity has to be there and to understand that, number one, we must pay respects to our elders. We must have tolerance as well and understand that they've worked hard to try and do something and they don't want that disturbed. And that it's not just egos, it's just a feeling that you don't want to lose what you fought for. But in the end, your success will be contagious and those old-time leaders will hop on board and everybody will be on the same ship in the same direction. That is what happened in the Hispanic community. I got a lot of pushback from people who for years were saying, we need to empower the Hispanic community, and then these same leaders were the ones who were giving me a hard time. And I guarantee you, if you ask Mr. Carrier, he gets more grief from Haitians than he does from anybody else. It's the nature. We hold our own people to a different standard. We hold our own to a different standard. We have to understand. That's not unique to you guys. That's all of us. It happened. So that's why it's important that we learn from each other. And sometimes somebody from another group telling you this, it registers more than one of our own, because that's just the nature of the way we are. Now, I come from very poor roots. Never in politics, never in a million years did I ever think I could be an assemblyman. I didn't even know what an assemblyman was when I was first approached to do this. Thank God 15 years later, I'm still here. I've learned a lot along the way. I've made a lot of friends. But I realized that when I got in to my seat, and we had that situation with our community, with the old-time leaders kind of pushing back on me, I realized that our community is very easily divided. And because I come from very poor roots, and many of the immigrant community who comes from poor roots, and even those who didn't, the reason they immigrated is because they had probably lost everything in their country. There was wars, there's all sorts of things. They were not in good shape when they got here and were trying to lift up their families. And what I found is that our community was very easily divided because coming from poor roots or coming from third world country, we are used to competing with each other for the little that there is. And that instinct is used by the powers that be here to divide us very easily. And that's why you'll see sometimes people lending themselves. Sometimes you'll even see a few Muslims supporting the Trump types because we're used to, you know, we have to compete with each other, and opportunities are easy to jump at by some people. You'll see that. But we have to police ourselves. We have to create that peer pressure amongst ourselves to say, no, that doesn't work. You can't promise somebody to deliver the Muslim community if that person, just because you say so and because you're getting an opportunity, right? There has to be some integrity. And this is where the evolution starts to take place. The first generation of immigrants is focused on surviving. Most of us have been through a lot in our own countries. We're happy to be here. We're happy to have an opportunity that we couldn't have in our own countries. Although we love our own countries, systems, politics, many things prevent us from creating a better life for our family. So we come here and we're given that opportunity in a country that is far from perfect, but at least we can promote some change. Far from perfect, difficult, sometimes there's racism, but there is some light at the end of the tunnel if we navigate it right. So that first generation is focused on their family, and mainly on their family only. That first generation, for the most part, has no time for politics, has no time for civic meetings, has no time for anything except, look, I'm happy. I'm happy with what we're doing. Let's focus on working. Let's first focus on lifting up our family. And that first generation comes here many times with a mentality that politics is problems. Because in our countries, politics is trouble. You don't want to be part of that. And no matter what we do, we're not going to change anything in our home countries. That's the attitude that we have many times. And then you have a second generation come up. That second generation has its... Oh, and by the way, in that first generation, you do have some leaders who rise to the top. And they start to get some recognition. And they start a dialogue with the whatever group you're from, whether it's non-Muslim or the non-Hispanic community, and they start to reach out. And that's where you see that first group, and you see a couple of leaders come up. And for the most part, they're goodwill ambassadors. Very important that they put you on the map and they start to put a different face on your community, on the powers that be. And then what happens is that group starts to open up the door. Then you get a new generation who comes up who has their feet in two cultures. They have their feet in your old culture from your country, and they have their one foot over here. And they realize that there's a different way to move our country, our community forward. And that we should not only be goodwill ambassadors, but that we should be part of this country that actually makes a change. And that if we came here and we're Hispanic and we're Muslim, that we shouldn't be asking the government to do something for us. We should be in government making policies, because that's what this country is about. Unless you're American Indian, everybody here is part of an immigrant group that did that, that demanded to be part at some point. And that is where the Muslim community is today on Long Island. The Muslim community is coming of age and is saying, it's not enough to give a few of us jobs to say you're a good guy. We want jobs. We want Muslims in positions of power. Not just political hack positions, we want Muslims making policy. But secondly, we want to see that policy. And when you're at the point now where, fine, we appreciate that elected officials will come to your mosque and they'll say, well, you're great people and I love Muslim people, and then, you know, they leave and then they join their colleagues spewing hate at the Muslim community and don't say anything, they stay silent, they don't do anything. You're at the point where you need to demand more than that. You need to say, no. What have you done this year in your legislative agenda? What laws have you passed that affect our community? Are my children able to eat halal food in the schools? Have you Have you passed any law that prevents anybody from randomly searching my wife at an airport with no other reason to go by? Have you done anything other than come and say that we're good people on our holidays? Or maybe election time, come by and make your quick speech and tell us how great we are and ask for a vote. We need a legislative agenda. And that is where MPAC comes in. Because MPAC has promised not only to organize the community, but to produce Muslim votes. Because when you produce Muslim votes, you will see government respond, right? Those non-Muslim elected officials will say, wow, I have this many registered Muslims in my community. I need to deliver something to them. I need to come, and words are not going to do it. I need to pass some laws. I need to defend them. I need to stop some of the bad things that are happening. And I need to bring them into government. That's what will happen when the registration process. And not only do you need that, but you also need the Muslim community to go to government, to go to Washington, to go to Albany every year at the beginning of session and say, this year, this is what we want. Silence is our enemy. And if you say you're with the Muslim community, then when you have elected officials standing up like Donald Trump saying we should prevent Muslims from coming to this country, you, if you stay silent, then you're part of it. If you don't speak out against that, or just privately tell me you don't like it, and you don't come out and hold your party accountable and hold your elected officials, then your silence is actually hurting us. We want to see some action. But again, the only way you can produce that action is to produce that hammer, which is your vote. So you have to start to get civic engagement at the voting booth. You have to register your kids. You have to insist that, you know, your young people, when they get 18, look, it's election day. Do me a favor. Take an hour and go vote. You all have to also do that. Make sure you do this. We have to, they are going to go on a concerted effort now to areas in Hicksville and look at the actual numbers of where we can get a South Asian or a Muslim elected with science, not with, you know, well, you know, we like this guy, so we're going to vote for him. No. Let's look and see if we have the votes. If we don't, can we register the votes? They're going to look at it very scientifically and find a way to make it happen. Another point I want to make is that we're hearing national dialogue about the Muslim community, whether they should be here. Ridiculous, totally ridiculous things. Every religion has had their extremists. Every religion, that those people don't need to apologize for what some crazy did. And every religion has had crazies do things, right? At the same time, there is no worse racism than self-racism. Muslim community is starting to feel, many are starting to feel complex, like they have to prove themselves. Like they have to prove like they're something that they're not. And the Muslim community needs to hold their head up high and say, I am an American living the American dream. I have a right to be part of government and make a better country, make a better America, but I don't have to apologize for what I have not done. Right. So those who keep saying, oh, the Muslim community must denounce terrorism, you guys have done it from the highest tower, from the loudest microphone. In fact, I attended a rally in Huntington, the Muslim community rejecting terrorism and declaring their pride at being American. Not one member of the press was there. But you'll see Fox 5, when some terrorist does something, trying to hold that against American citizens. So we must not be racist against ourselves and accept things that place us in a position of being second-class citizens. Please. The Hispanic community has done it too, and many times in the African-American community feels that's part of what we have to do. In order to make it, we can't really say nothing about this. I was a police officer for 20 years, and I organized the Black and Hispanic office, and I had officers. We ended up suing our police department for racism. These were police officers doing it, and we won the lawsuit. But I had fellow officers of color saying, no, look, you know, we have to be thick-skinned. We have to, you know, look, we can't be so sensitive and working. And, you know, I would say, well, hold on a second. Why must somebody denigrate my race to do their job. Why must I accept that? Why must I accept somebody talking to somebody who could be my mother, who could be my brother, in that way? I guarantee you, if I went after a Caucasian person and started saying things, they would equally, and the police department say, this guy's got a problem. Nobody else has to tolerate that. I should not have to tolerate that, and you should have enough respect for yourself not to tolerate that. So the Muslim community is here to live the American dream. In fact, they're living an American dream, and many, some will say, more than an American who was born here, because you're actually doing something. You actually struggled. You actually overcame barriers for that American dream. You didn't get it by birthright. You got it by a struggle and a vision for your family, that no mountain, no ocean, no war, no government was going to get in the way of you doing what you had to do for your family. That is what the American dream is. That is what this present country was built on. People who were not able to get what they wanted, their quality of life somewhere else, and they came here and built it their way. So if this government becomes a better government by attending to the needs of the Muslim community, by accommodating things in schools, by preventing racial profiling and discrimination the way they do from every other group, then the Muslim community has pushed for those things and made this a better country. You have it in your hands. You have it in your hands to change the way things go about. But we must get our house in order. MPACT is the way to do it. And what happens is, for the most part, the Muslim community, and I'm sorry to go long, but it's important that we talk about these things and we start to think about it. It's important the Muslim community starts to think about the points that I'm making, because we walk away from it with a different way of looking at things, you know. And what happens is that, for the most part, immigrant community is the only place that they, for the most part, that they have organizations is in their places of worship, your mosque. In my case, in Hispanics, it's the church. And people work and they're struggling to survive, but the only way, place they will congregate as a group is in their places of worship. But places of worship focus on faith, not, for the most part, not civic and political participation. And that is why, in fact, it's prohibited for a mosque to endorse candidates or a church to do that. So that is why it's important that the Muslim community get educated on the civic responsibility and what this really means for your people. In the end, this will be the tide that rises all ships. Every year, MPAC will be at a table calling every elected official that represents Muslim areas where there's a lot of Muslims, calling them to a yearly meeting saying, what do you plan to do this year? Or, last year, you promised us this, what happened? Did you deliver? Either thank you for delivering, or why did you not deliver? But you must produce accountability. As Americans, you have an absolute right. You have an absolute right to expect government to respond to you. You're not asking for anything that any other American isn't entitled to. So let's hold our heads up high with pride. In the end, MPAC will be the tide that rises all ships. May God bless you all. And together, we will get there. Thank you.
I want to welcome you all. I want to welcome our distinguished guests, Mr. Phil Remmers, Mr. Sledges, our family and friends who have gathered on this occasion. My speech is going to be sweet and short. And basically, it's more directed towards American Muslim women. We all know we are living in difficult times in the US today. There is Islamophobia everywhere, and Muslims are being defined by others. It is time that American Muslim women stand up for their rights and respect. And how can this be achieved? This can be achieved by participating in the fields of activism, humanitarian work, public relations, as well as government, to name a few. This is the right which is given to us by God. There is an African saying that educating a man is educating an individual, and educating a woman is educating a community. We may not see the drastic changes immediately, But the beauty of women is that we are the soldiers of future. Our future generations will prosper and be secured by the steps and actions which we take today. So I urge you all to stand up, be vocal, be visible, and be proud of it. Participate in your neighborhoods. Participate in your local schools. Join the PTA, join Board of Education. If anything, be chaperones. Participate and volunteer in your local libraries, in your local schools, in your local hospitals, community hospitals. Also, participate in all the charity work which is going on in your community. And participate in the interfaith dialogue. This is very important. Also, very, very important, get registered to vote. And vote in the general as well as local elections. We don't think, we just think, I know lots of us are registered and we vote in the general elections and we don't realize how important it is to participate in local elections. Educate your children, your spouse, your family members to participate in your neighborhoods and get registered. In this way, we can work together for the betterment of our Muslim community as well as American society. Thank you.
Now I'm going to invite Mr. Athar Tirmizi. He is the fellow that you can ask any question that you have about AMPAC. He can answer you. He can satisfy you. He has tons of knowledge. And he's working very hard towards the Muslim community. And he wants to bring us up through his efforts, him and Amr Sultan both.
I do not take, I have to say, your attendance and this audience lightly. I don't. Each and every one of you guys, I'm extremely, extremely thankful for being here. Like you, I have to say, myself being an American Muslim, I'm very concerned with all the rhetoric. And you know, this speech comes at a very crucial time, and not dinner time, because I know you guys are waiting for that too, but the 2016 election. It's extremely important how we get together at this point. So as you guys know, as everybody has stressed, you know, from Dr. Sabaha to Assemblyman Ramos, to Kerry Salaj's legislator over here, you know, Amr as the president of AMPAC, we do need to get involved. We do need to get engaged. And we need to get away from the ideas that we can just have dinners and family gatherings, and go on Facebook and talk about it. Oh my God, there was a vandalism in a mosque. I don't like it. Or comment on the Facebook. Or, you know, post picture on Instagram. No, we cannot do that anymore. What we cannot do is just sit there, ideally, you know, and not be engaged and involved and talk about all these things that are happening. So what can we do? What can we do is, you know, like Amir has said, Dr. Sabahat, our assemblyman, our legislator, how to get engaged and what is the vehicle. And Amir and I, you know, with my mentor and my guidance from Assemblyman Ramos, did develop AMPAC. And the reason for AMPAC was that we want to create an organization that's a policy-based organization, not an organization that says, hey, listen, we're going to have a Qawwali night, so come on. And, you know, support us. No, we don't want to have an organization to say, hey, we're having a dinner at our house. No, we want to have an organization that will tell you, listen, you support us now, have some blind faith. Next year, we're coming back to tell you what we did. You know, we are working with Afghani community, because I know we have Afghans in our audience. We're working with African-American community, with Teresa Sanders. You know, a whole bunch of Hispanic communities, Assemblyman Ramos, have opened up, you know, doors to us. You know, I was just talking to Legislator Salajas before and talk about working together. So we do need to get engaged. And I know some of you guys in the audience, and most of you guys don't know me and I don't know you. But I say, this is the time. Let's get together. We have our registration forms in the back that you guys can get. And of course, if you want to become a member, do become a member. But if you don't want to become a member, because there is a fee for it, do fill it out and check off that you want a monthly newsletter. Because what that will tell you, maybe you don't have a faith in us for now, but on the quarterly basis, we will be telling you what we are doing. Every single quarter, which will let you know that, okay, we are not just an organization that will just talk and have parties and dinners and that will be the end of it. No, we will come and we will tell you what exactly what we are about. So with that, I'm going to roll about our agenda for 2016. And this is where you guys come in handy for us. So, I have put down the agenda for all you guys, and if you guys don't have it, I'm just going to go over. We are going to create the first ever Muslim task force in New York State, and it will be on the state level, inshallah. We will create a lobby day. Come to think of it, we have people who've been living in New York alone for 30, 40, 50 years, but we don't go up to our legislators to say up in Albany, like Assemblyman Ramos said, that, hey, listen, this is what we want. But the silence is the killer. So what we need a Muslim lobby day. We'll be to go to Albany and say, hey, listen, this is our community. These are our demands. What can you deliver for us? We also want to have an extensive voter registration drive, and our goal as high as may be, but we want to have 5,000 to 10,000 new voters registered before 2016 election, because as you can see, the inactivity that we have shown in the last so many years in our local politics have led to where we are today. We want to create the first ever Muslim Chambers of Commerce on Long Island. We have a huge business community and we have no connection with each other. So we need a kind of organization that propagates our business causes. We want to create a scholarship program for our kids. Our younger generation, we are not going to do any justice to them if we are keep saying to them, hey, listen, become a doctor. And no offense, it's about the money. You know, we need doctors because we need your money. But we also need people who are in the government. We need people who are in mass media, communication, journalism. I just met a young girl, Mavish. I was talking to her. She's sitting in the back. And I told her, she's the kind of person I need to know because these are the people who are our future. Because right now, who's writing our narrative? Not us. So when you let somebody else write your narrative, guess what happens? Those are the people going to write your narrative and not us. So we need to be engaged to write our own narrative. And last but not least, we're going to get committee members elected by Democratic Party in Suffolk County. Now, these six items, I will tell you what, I will call you again next year. Ticket will be $250, but I will make sure that you guys are known that these are not just talking points. These are the items that we have worked and delivered for the betterment of our community. And that's what, you know, I have to say that I'm here for, Am is here for, Nadeem Mahmoud Sawad Mani, and all of you guys. And, you know, Assemblyman Ramos, you know, Legislative Lodges. So I just want to make sure that you guys do walk away with the understanding that the importance of MPAC and the need for MPAC is very real. It's not like any other organization that I have seen and that I can promise you that you will see. We are passionate about what we do and we are passionate about our community. And we are here for the duration of dinner. I have my cards. I have his cards. You can call us, email us, talk to us. Whatever you want to do, however you want to get in communication with us, do it. And inshallah, next year, 2017, you will see bigger and better things happening. Thank you very much, and assalamu alaikum.
My name is Nayyad Imam. My name is Long Island Muslim Alliance. And this is a good step for the Muslim Political Action Committee. اور مسلمانوں کو انوالو ہونا چاہیے یہاں کی پولیٹکس میں بہت ضروری خاص طور سے آج کل کے حالات میں جو لوگ یہاں کی پولیٹکس کو فالو کر رہے ہیں انہوں نے دیکھا ہوگا کہ ڈونلڈ ٹرمپ نے جو کچھ بھی کہا ہے مسلمانوں کے بارے میں ایکچولی ہم سب لوگوں کو اس کا شکر گزار ہونا چاہیے کیونکہ اس نے ایک ایسے مسئلے کو چھیڑا ہے جس پہ عموماً پولیٹیشین جو ہیں جو یہاں کے لوکل پولیٹیشین ہیں وہ بات کرتے ہوئے گھبراتے ہیں اور ہر چیز کو ذرا لگی لپٹی رکھتے ہیں تاکہ بالکل وہ انگلش میں جو کہتے ہیں نا پولیٹیکلی کریکٹ جو اسٹیٹمنٹ ہوتا ہے وہ دیتے ہیں ڈونلڈ ٹرمپ نے وہ بات کھول کے کہہ دی جو ہر mostly har politician ke dil mein hai zuban pe nahi aati hai kyunki to uski wajah se hame uska shukrgar hona chahiye ki usne is masle ko actually bilkul saream kar diya aur har aadmi is pe baat kar raha hai to ab agar koi musalman politics mein involved nahi hona chahta hai aur ghar pe baith rehna chahta hai to isse zyada zyadti wo na sirf apne sath apni qaum ke sath apne bachon ke sath apne aane wali nasl ke sath karega aap kisi bhi party ko join kare Democrat, Republican, Green, Blue Party. लेकिन आप ज़रूर ज्वाइन करें और आप पॉलिटिक्स का हिस्सा बने आप वोट दें सबसे पहले रजिस्टर हों उसके बाद बेहतर होगा कि आप अपनी कम्यूनिटी के साथ मिल के किसी भी कैंडिडेट को वोट दें आमिर सुल्तान साहब ने जो काम शुरू किया है बहुत अच्छा है अल्लाह इनको इसकी जजा दे और इंशाल्लाह इसके दूरदर्श नतज निकलेंगे
मेरा नाम उस्मा है और हम यहीं लॉन्ग आइलैंड से हैं और सबाहत ने आज इनवाइट किया और हम लोग चाहते हैं कि ये जो ऑर्गेनाइजेशन बनाई है मुस्लिम पॉलिटिकल एक्शन कमेटी यूएसए तो इसमें हमारी वॉइस भी हर्ड हो और अब से पहले कभी हमें ख्याल नहीं आया कि हमें बिसाइड्स कैजुअल पार्टीज़ के कुछ और भी करना चाहिए तो आई थिंक इट्स अ गुड प्लेटफॉर्म एंड वी वॉन्ट आर वॉइस टू बी हर्ड एंड आई होप इट गोज़ टू wherever it's supposed to be going
mera naam uzma bukhari hai aur hum log aaj yahan ikatthe hue hain kyunki ye ek political event hua hai jo sabahat ne arrange kiya hai yahan pe mashallah sab apne american politicians aa rahe hain aur ab hum sab musalmanon ne bahut sare musalmanon ne ye realize kiya hai ki is tarah baat nahi ban sakti ki hum sirf gharon mein baithe rahe aur bachchon ko engineer doctors bana de क्योंकि जो पिछले हालात हुए हैं हमें बहुत बेबसी फील हुई है कि अपनी वॉइस उठाई और हमें समझ नहीं आती थी कि हम किसके पास जाएं तो अब ये जो इन्होंने शुरू किया ऑर्गेनाइजेशन हम इसको सपोर्ट करते हैं और होप करते हैं कि हमारे बच्चे भी हमें ज्वाइन करें और इंशाल्लाह करेंगे क्योंकि ये सब आने वाली नस्लों के लिए उनके जो यहाँ बच्चे और बच्चों के भी माशाल्लाह बच्चे होने हैं तो मुसलमानों को और ख़ास पाकिस्तानियों को और हम सब बल्कि मुसलमानों को चाहिए कि अपने यहाँ पे अपनी एक होने का एहसास इनको दिलाएं और इनको बताएं कि ये टेररिज्म से हमारा कोई वास्ता नहीं है हम एक अमन पसंद हमारे तो मज़हब का ही मतलब है इस्लाम का क्या मतलब है सलामती है तो ये जो टीवी पे हर वक्त प्रोपेगेंडा ये लोग करते रहते हैं कि बाबेरियन है और फलाना है इस तरह की कोई बात नहीं है तो लेकिन अब पहले हमें समझ नहीं आती थी कि हम किधर जाएं तो अब एक ये छोटी सी अब ये चीज़ शुरू हुई है और इसको हम पूरी तरीके से सपोर्ट करेंगे सारे इंशाल्लाह और एक आवाज़ अपनी असम्बली में इनके कांग्रेस में इनके जो इवेंट्स होते हैं इनमें बताएँगे तो अल्लाह करेगा इंशाल्लाह कोई हमारी भी कोई आवाज़ उठेगी इंशाल्लाह
अस्सलाम वालेकुम आई थिंक दिस न्यू पॉलिटिकल एक्टिविटी दैट्स बीन गोइंग ऑन इट्स वेरी क्रूशियल इट्स वेरी वाइटल एंड आई थिंक वी हैव टू कम इनटू अ न्यू यू नो मेनस्ट्रीम पॉलिटिक्स एंड आई थिंक आमिर हैज डन अ फैबुलस जॉब ही इज ब्रिंगिंग द कम्युनिटी हियर एंड इंशाल्लाह यू नो विल ब्रिंग अ गुड चेंज विद दिस न्यू कमेटी विल सपोर्ट इन व्हाटएवर वे यू नो फाइनेंशियली एंड इमोशनली एंड फिजिकली एंड ब्रिंगिंग मोर पीपल हियर एंड मेकिंग द कम्युनिटी अवेयर ऑफ दिस फोरम
My name is Dr. Parvez Iqbal, and about the Muslim Action Committee, Muslim Pakistani Action Committee. Well, I like to support it, and I think they are doing a wonderful job in reaching out to the people, reaching out to the politicians, and concentrating on bringing the Muslims, especially from Pakistani origin, into the flocks of the. voter list so they can vote I think including ourselves registering as a voter this should be our main priority one of the most important thing we can do at present is to register will give us the opportunity to raise our voice this will give us opportunity to be heard we are here the muslims are here the pakistani muslims are here in pretty large number but unfortunately up to now the voice has not been recognized or the importance has not been given to this voice and they have been many time discriminated not treated well because nobody understand that such a big number exists over here. So I think the first and more what they are doing is bringing Muslims into the flock so we can vote, we can register, we can vote, and we can choose a person who is the best suited and speaks for us.
Today is actually a historic day here on Long Island. We have the Muslim Political Action Committee, which has organized the Muslim community to start to get involved in civic and political activity so that government starts to respond with a legislative agenda, not just getting jobs, not just, you know, feel-good speeches from elected officials, but actually getting laws passed that address the needs of the Muslim community. And that includes diversifying government and making sure that we get Muslims working for government, actually creating those policies. So we've started in my office, actually. We've hired several Muslims and who are, you know, at the table actually creating policy. We're hoping that this year some good laws come out that address the needs of the Muslim community. Political action committees don't get money from government, they get money from people. And what it is, it's a grassroots movement. And what we're seeing on Long Island is that the Muslim community is coming of age. This is part of an evolution that every ethnic group that comes to this country goes through. The first generation has a difficult time just focusing on surviving and adjusting to a new life. And then the second generation, which we're seeing with the Muslim community here, starts, since they have their feet in two cultures, have two different optics on things, and they start developing their community and organizing their community to integrate themselves into mainstream society and the infrastructure of government. That is what we're seeing today with the Muslim community. It's a very proud day.
My name is Iman Bukhari, and we're here to make a stronger voice for the Muslim community, not only in the political world, but everywhere, like for job opportunities, you know, with all the attacks happening lately. We definitely want to make a voice for us. People have been looking down on us. So we just want to make a stronger voice and show the people that Muslims are important. We are just as, we are American citizens just as anybody else. Not only Pakistani Muslims, everybody, you know.
Arham Sheikh, I go to school here, and I think our number one priority is to show that Muslims are a part of the community here, and if Muslims are considered a part of the community, they'll be considered the same as the rest of the people here. And since the rest of the people in the community get to voice their opinions, then the Muslims should have an opportunity to voice their opinion as well.
I'm so glad to be here, to be invited by a lot of great friends like Amir Sultan and Malik Abid, people who have helped me in my political career. But I'm here tonight to explain to this great audience that it is not just about supporting me. We must create opportunity for other people and other communities, and specifically the South Asian and Muslim community. Very important. My district has a very large growing South Asian population, and I would like to see in the next couple of years the first South Asian representing Nassau County in office. And we must do that by talking about our experiences, about organizing, about putting our heads together and showing that there is a path. You know, it's great to be involved in politics, to know about politics, but we have to organize and inspire and allow, and most importantly, register other people to vote. And so this is a great time in American politics where if you do not say anything, then you are not represented. So I'm here to talk with a lot of great friends about how we can really build together. The Muslim Political Action Committee, MPAC, is a great organization that already helped pull off one of the first parades that we saw last year in Hicksville about this culture representing themselves and showing the world what their culture is really about. I prefer that we define ourselves and other people define us. And by having a political action committee, we are defining and paving a way for our own future.
MPAC ایک نئی ایسوسیشن بنی ہے جس میں کہ خاص طور پہ تمام مسلمانوں کو اکٹھا کیا جا رہا ہے اور ہم کام کر رہے ہیں اپنے بچوں کے لیے اور ان کے بچوں کے لیے تو ایک ایسی آرگنائزیشن بنائی جا رہی ہے جس میں کہ ہر کوئی شامل ہو سکتا ہے تاکہ ہمارے جو اغراض و مقاصد ہیں ان کو ہم واشنگٹن تک لے جائیں اور بات چیت کر سکیں جا کے ان لوگوں سے those who make decisions in United States. So اس وجہ سے یہاں پہ لوگ جمع ہو رہے ہیں پاکستانی جمع ہو رہے ہیں اور یہاں پہ اسمبلی مین ہیں یہاں پہ کانگریس مین آ رہے ہیں یہاں پہ تو وہ سب بھی یہی بات کہہ رہے ہیں کہ مسلمانوں کے لیے کوئی جگہ ہونی چاہیے مسلمانوں کو اپنی آواز اٹھانی چاہیے مسلمانوں کو یہاں کی جو سیاست ہے اس میں شامل ہونا چاہیے So that is the reason. Of course, I'm part of the community and I'm always involved in things like that. So I'm here and doing something for my children, their children, and all the youngsters from Pakistan and youngsters from our community, Muslim community.
ये बड़ी अच्छी कोशिश है और मेरा ख्याल है कि इस बार टाइम हमारे मुसलमानों को आगे आना चाहिए और हमें अपना शेयर चाहिए हर जगह पर. आई मीन पॉलिटिकली, सोशली, और सोशली तो माशाल्लाह काफ़ी आगे चले गए हैं, लेकिन अभी पॉलिटिकली इन मेन स्ट्रीम के ऊपर हमें अपना नाम लेके आना चाहिए, हमारे यूथ को आगे आना चाहिए. बेसिकली वी आर इग्नोरिंग अवर यूथ. यूथ कम इन and this the Muslim Action Committee, I think it will it's a good cause. It will do better for the Muslim community.
My name is May. I think IMPACT is very important. The reason I came here is to learn from them and how to create a chapter in New Jersey for the youth kit, the Muslim youth kit in New Jersey, and so we can all band together and grow as a community. And I think these plans are very important, especially in scholarship. With a lot of kids going to school, tuition is growing at an average rate of 6%. How are they going to get money from it if scholarships not created? Most kids right now comes out with a mortgage, and how they going to? It's going to take them 20, 30 years going paying back off. Also, same time, there's so much money available from grant. There are over $189 billion of grants available the U.S. government give. But the whole thing is, not many people know how to tap into it. So that's one way of educating them how to tap into getting the grant.
This is an excellent forum. What I learned today from AMPAC Assemblyman Ramos, I think the speech that he gave was an eye-opener for our community like us, that we have to stand for our rights. We are actively participating in this kind of movement will get us in the forefront and get our rights accepted. We have to stop taking the apologetic attitude that we have to justify ourselves for not being terrorists or we denounce terrorism, but we, on the other hand, we have to claim our right, we're Muslim Americans who are part and parcel of this society, and that it is our right, our constitutional right, to be recognized as first-class citizens. We have learned, we have to learn to live with pride and claim our right.
Assalamu alaikum, my name is Amir Sultan. I'm president of IMPACT USA, first organization, political organization that is registered with Board of Elections in the state of New York to work as a lobby firm in a political arena. The need for IMPACT is many, many folds, but it's very vital now for us to start this organization and fight the Islamophobia and the xenophobia which is being created by people, demagogues like Donald Trump and more people like that. They're using the name of Muslim community for their personal gains, for their political gains. We need to join hands, we need to come together and fight against these people for our future and for the future of our children. So I'm asking the community to join us, become members, become directors, bring in ideas, bring in your support, bring in votes, help us in voter registration, help us in fundraising, and work with us. Together, we can make things happen for the Muslim community.